Inside a building on the west side of Tiananmen Square in Beijing, 2,980 members of the National People's Conference of China ratified a plan that would chart the course of its now massive economy for the next 5 years. It was 2021, and of all its 14 iterations, this particular five-year blueprint was crucial. It needed to jumpstart a rapid transition towards a zero-carbon economy. Because for the last two decades, China has been the poster child of runaway emissions.
China's most polluted.
The world's biggest emitter, China.
China has completed the construction of the country's biggest coal power station.
For China, economic expansion seems to come before climate protection.
In the eyes of the world, and especially those in the US, China is the boogeyman of climate change. It's easy to continue extracting and burning fossil fuels on American soil when you can point across the Pacific and claim that China is doing far worse. But is China really to blame? That's a complicated question, and there's a lot to unpack with China's environmental record, like how its historical emissions stack up to other countries, what's China's toll on the planet right now, and is this country of more than 1.4 billion people doing anything to curb this graph. So today, we dive into China's impact on climate change. This video is made possible by Ground News. Stick around to the end of this video to find out how to navigate the news with clarity and confidence. The nature of China's economy has long been debated. After the Communist Revolution under Mao, China seemed well on its way to more advanced forms of socialism. But after Mao's death and the reforms of his successor, Deng Xiaoping, the country seemed to turn a little ways back towards capitalism. Today, the waters of China's economy are murky. Is it capitalist? Is it socialist? Is it somewhere in between? It seems that, depending on the decade, China has either been more socialist or less. The Chinese Communist Party, or CCP for short, under the current president Xi Jinping, however, firmly asserts that they operate under socialism with Chinese characteristics, allowing for markets and private ownership to exist as long as they are useful in developing the forces of production. As a result, the actual workings of Chinese socialism is more akin to state capitalism, or a market economy controlled and heavily influenced by the ruling legislative body. Often, the over 1,000 Chinese billionaires are highlighted to explain that China functions within very much a capitalist economy. But the reality is much deeper than that, because socialism and capitalism is at its core all about how production in the workplace is organized. Under socialism, the workplace is democratically controlled by all laborers involved in production, producing goods for use rather than for profit. While under capitalism, the workplace is owned and controlled by just a few who decide how that production is run. And this economy is based on profits over use. Of course, these are very limited and flawed definitions. Marx, Engels, and their intellectual descendants have spent centuries debating the shapes of these two modes of production. But for the sake of this video, they're adequate enough. And when we use these definitions to understand socialism instead of how much stuff the state does, it's clear that China very much still has its hand in the capitalist mode of production. But China's politics and economics are not set in stone. With the right conditions, an upsurge of working class pressure, China might very well accelerate towards a more socialist and ultimately communist stage of development. China's economy is a mix of privately owned and state-owned enterprises that function within a profit-oriented market. The ultimate question about China's future is whether the Chinese Communist Party is wielding market forces in order to carve an eventual path towards socialism, or whether they've lost control of the reins and these market forces are driving China back towards a more capitalist mode of production. The answer to that question is unclear, but whichever path China travels down will certainly have massive ramifications on global emissions. If you stack up China's current emissions output against any other country in the world, it paints a pretty clear picture. Asia's most populous country is by far the world's biggest polluter. But here's a little secret. That wasn't always the case. For most of the last two centuries, ever since fossil fuels were siphoned out of the earth and burned into the air, China wasn't even on the map in terms of emissions. England, and then soon after the United States, spent most of the 19th century and all of the 20th century pumping millions of tons of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere well before China did. Emissions that have locked the world into soaring past the maximum amount of CO2 we can release for 1.5 degrees and even 2 degrees Celsius of warming. Winds stacked up against those two centuries of emissions, China's current pollution seems a little less intense. This doesn't mean that China's current trajectory isn't worrying, but instead that when we consider carbon emissions, we need to consider them cumulatively. Carbon dioxide can linger in the atmosphere for up to 300 to 1,000 years. When we look at it from this perspective, the United States and Europe are the real culprits. They account for the most cumulative emissions since 1750. The United States alone is responsible for a quarter of all of the world's historical emissions, while China has emitted just half of them. So as much as politicians in the United States like to point at China's current annual emissions and claim that the country has to be doing more, the reality is that the US and its European counterparts were the ones that dug us into this deep climate crisis hole in the first place. That being said, US emissions have been dropping, and it seems like they're handing off the shovel to China, who's now furiously digging us deeper into a hole of climate chaos. In 2008, China had a smog problem. The Olympics were right around the corner, and Beijing looked like this. There were days upon days when people couldn't go outside because the air quality was too low. But when you glance back through history, China's smog problem was nothing new. Beijing looked very much like LA in 1955 or London in 1952. But China wanted blue skies for the 2008 Olympics. And in an effort to lighten the heavy pollutants spoiling the air, they tightened air quality standards and restricted car use around major cities. Initiatives that they continued sporadically and then in force after 2013. This seems to have worked. While it still exists, China's smog problem has certainly improved as a result. But the coal plants at the source of these dark clouds are still firing away. It's here, at the heart of the coal furnace, where China's emissions problems lie. Coal powers China, plain and simple.
China's projected to build as much as 1,230 gigawatts of new coal-fired power capacity till 2025.
To fuel the massive increase in energy consumption over the last two decades, China has turned to mining and burning coal in its three northern regions of Shaanxi, Inner Mongolia, and Shaanxi. Deemed the Coal Triangle, these three provinces produced 70% of the country's 4 billion ton yearly coal output, according to Carbon Brief. Coal that then gets shipped around the country to fuel heavy industry like steel production, as well as fuel the explosion of residential energy use. Because the fact of the matter is that China's energy use today is gargantuan. Taken all together, China's population uses 43,791 terawatt hours of energy per year, which is almost double that of the United States. This coal-soaked energy means that China's yearly emissions are substantial. China generated 11.47 billion tons of carbon dioxide emissions in 2021 alone, accounting for 27% of the whole world's emissions footprint. For perspective, the US accounted for 13.5%. But here's the thing. China is also the most populous country in the world. It's home to almost four times more people than the United States. So when you narrow down into emissions per person, China is actually pretty efficient. It ranks 48th against the per capita emissions of all other countries. The United States is 14th. So while China's overall emissions and energy use is certainly large, we can't ignore the fact that its people are creating significantly less impact than many other countries, especially if you factor in exports, because China is the factory of the world. The carbon dioxide churning out of its coal plants is attached to phones and shirts that are bought up by Americans and Europeans thirsty for a good deal. As a piece from Carbon Brief notes, gleaning information from China's state media, the prefecture of Dongguan produces one in every three toys, one in every five smartphones, and one in every 10 pairs of trainers globally. So when we take exported goods out of the picture, China's emissions drop by 14%, while the United States' footprint rises 7.7%. But regardless of China's current emissions, per person efficiency, or historical responsibility, the fact of the matter is they are still on an unsustainable path. In part, this is due to their continued construction of bigger and bigger coal plants and expansion of oil pipeline infrastructure across the country, negating any renewable technology expansion, which we'll talk a little bit about later. In a time when Chinese leadership needs to be doing the exact opposite, they're increasing fossil fuel output. Chinese coal production reached a record high in 2022. That is what's causing a graph like this. Emissions in China are still on the rise, and they need to be rapidly curbed in order to stave off catastrophic climate change, a fact which the Chinese government recognizes and actually seems to be acting on. The question is, are they doing enough? Flying over the remote Golmud Solar Park in Qinghai Province in China might take a little while. That's because it's the second largest solar panel installation in the world, and it's just one of the many renewable behemoths on Chinese soil that has come online in the last decade. Installations that are called clean energy bases that seek to rapidly push China towards a less coal-dependent future. And if China's 2021 five-year plan is any indication, these kinds of solar, wind, and battery technologies are set to blossom throughout China. Through the plan, President Xi Jinping and his party laid out high-level climate targets, the specific logistics of which will be planned and coordinated by the 22 provinces throughout mainland China. But the government's 14th five-year plan didn't set targets based on absolute emissions or energy usage. Instead, they focused on carbon dioxide intensity, or how clean their energy mixes, and energy intensity. The goal over the next 5 years is an 18% reduction of carbon dioxide intensity and a 13.5% reduction of energy intensity. These two targets seek to set China up to reach much longer-term targets, which President Xi Jinping announced through a speech in 2020.
We will reach the peaking of CO2 emission before 2030 and reach carbon neutrality before 2060.
To reach those goals, the government poured $546 billion into low-carbon infrastructure during 2022 alone, infusing renewable projects like the Golmud solar installation, as well as wind, battery, and electric vehicle production with financial backing. That number is almost four times what the United States and the European Union invested into renewables in 2022. And that money is already fueling a surge in renewable energy production throughout China's provinces. Since 2011, the share of China's electricity that comes from fossil fuels dropped by over 14%. Meanwhile, the percentage of China's renewable electricity capacity has doubled over the same period. According to a prediction from the International Energy Agency, China will install almost half of the world's renewable energy capacity over the next 5 years. But solar and wind production is only part of the battle. China is also leading a massive expansion of battery power alongside electric transportation. The state produced 77% of the world's lithium battery capacity in 2022 and is predicted to grow to seven times that production by 2027. Meanwhile, the Chinese state-owned company BYD has consistently dwarfed all other competitors in global electric vehicle sales. And China has also spent decades building out the biggest and extensively used high-speed rail networks in the world. That is a massive infrastructural achievement, especially when combined with the electrification of public transportation networks in cities like Shenzhen, which hosts a fleet of over 16,000 electric buses and 22,000 electric taxis. The city is a gold standard of electrifying public transit. Through these initiatives, China is revealing just what is possible in a transition to a zero-carbon economy. And to top it all off, the CCP has a long history of tree planting projects, the effect of which is still debated. Since 1978, the desert provinces of China have witnessed the world's biggest afforestation project. To turn back the creep of the Gobi Desert, China has planted over 66 billion trees, completely terraforming the landscape. And now the government has pledged to plant and conserve 70 billion trees by 2030. While experts remain skeptical about the effectiveness of this project, it's undoubtedly an impressive feat of potential carbon sequestration. Despite all of these impressive projects to ward off emissions, Climate Action Tracker has deemed the CCP's plans and policies highly insufficient, arguing that while China's five-year plans and clean energy projects have led to increased decarbonization, they are ultimately not ambitious enough and will lead us down a path towards 3 degrees Celsius of warming. So while China is currently the leader of the pack in terms of renewable capacity and zero carbon infrastructure, in a world where governments have hemmed and hawed about minimizing carbon emissions, that is actually a low bar. The country could be doing so much more. Whether through the electrified buses of Shenzhen, the high-speed rail rolling through Chengdu, or the gargantuan offshore wind power project in Taiwan Strait, China reveals that the building out of a zero-carbon electrified world right now is not only possible, but achievable. They show that in order to create a rapid transition to a zero-carbon economy, we can't just wait and let the market decide. We need state intervention. Whether that's through the imperfect plans of the new $370 billion US climate package or through China's massive renewable infrastructural investments. Because as IPCC report after IPCC report has urged, we need to be making unprecedented transformational action right now. And crucially, these massive investments in a clean world need to be democratically planned. Because China also reveals that this transition can have a dark side, one that requires substantial human and material extraction. It reveals that if we are to truly create a transition that is just and equitable, we need to do more than just replace all fossil fuels with renewable alternatives, all gas-guzzling cars with electric ones. We need to be focusing on understanding and right-sizing production while seeking full worker control of our economy, so that we don't need to build as much, extract as much, and pollute as much to wrest ourselves away from fossil fuels. Indeed, China's massive build-out of battery and renewable technologies has left it with an insatiable appetite for precious metals and minerals. Minerals that are most often found in the Democratic Republic of Congo. And chief among those minerals is cobalt. The journey of that blue rock from the soils of the Congo to the batteries of Beijing is marked with hyper-exploitation, imperialism, and environmental destruction. Which is why in next month's video, I dive into the rarely told reality of the gruesome conditions powering the renewable revolution. And China has a big hand in it. It's essentially the part two of this video, and if you're a Nebula subscriber, you can watch that video right now. And while you're on Nebula, you can also get access to exclusive series like Polymatter's China Actually, which dives into the reality of China. It's a must-watch if you enjoyed this video, and does a great job clearing up misconceptions about China. But as much as those long-form videos are important, it's crucial to stay up to date with what's happening in the world right now. Like China's recent approval of increased coal production, or the climate protests in Berlin shutting down major city streets. And one of the best ways to stay up to date with these ongoing stories is Ground News. I've been using Ground News for a long time and really appreciate how clear and simple it makes current events. Ground News is a website and app that collects over 50,000 media sources into one place and lets you compare how headlines are being covered across the political spectrum. This is crucial for not only understanding exactly how the news is being covered, but it also helps build your media analysis skills along the way, so that when you encounter a media source in the wild, you know their biases. Because Ground News makes it easy to decipher what's really going on by providing ownership, bias, and factuality ratings for each source. For literally any story, like that one on China's recent approval of increased coal power, I can look at how many sources are reporting it, as well as the political leaning of those that are covering the event. I can also check how reliable all of those sources are, and even who owns them. And when that's not enough, Ground News allows you to do side-by-side comparisons of headlines to understand how different media organizations are portraying the issue. And they even have a handy blind spot tool to help you discover stories that you might never have seen. Ground News is an extremely powerful tool for navigating the news. I use it literally every day. So if you want to have that clarity when you read the news, head to ground.news/OCC or click the link in the description and subscribe to make media a whole lot more transparent in your everyday life. Otherwise, consider watching the OCC video on screen right now about radical climate futures, or support our changing climate on Nebula by clicking the link on screen right now. And I will see you next month.